United States, most of us grow up with the expectation when we go to school of having a school nurse, someone there in the building with us, even from their very earliest ages. And it goes all the way through. Even corporations have their own clinics and nurses on staff who are there all the time. Mars Hill College is one of those institutions, like all others, who have an infirmary. And the infirmary here at the college is a very special place indeed, because it was made special by Ellen Coomer, who is sitting right here. Ellen, I went back and looked at the dates of your service here, and you served 26 years and then came back after that for almost another year to do a second stint. So you, from the last 25 years of the century, you were a presence on campus. Tell me about how you got your job to come to Mars Hill College.
Okay. It was because of Dr. Duck, actually. And my son, we were getting ready to move back from Florida, and I had plans to work at Veterans. And my son had an asthma attack, so I took him to Dr. Duck's house, and he treated him, and then he started asking me about my nursing career and all that. And we just talked, and he didn't say any more. And then the very next day, he called my parents where we were and wanted to know if I wanted to come for an interview. And I thought, not really. You know, but I thought he was so gracious right. that night that I would at least do it, you know, so I did. And I was hired that day. Without checking my references or anything.
Well, this was in 1970.
They were desperate.
This was 1973. And you had, of course, you have a history in the county because you grew up in the county. Did you know Dr. Duck? This is, we're talking to Otis Duck, who was the medical director at the college. Did you know him as you were growing up? Did you know who he was?
No, I didn't. I knew his reputation, you know, right. but my parents knew him.
Right.
Because I left Madison County when I was barely 17 and went to Berea to school right. and met my husband there, and we lived away 17 years.
So actually he was a name and a presence, but not someone you actually knew. Tell me a little bit about, was it Grapevine, the section where you grew up? Or mm-hmm. Tell me about
it. I was actually born on Big Laurel.
Big Laurel.
But my mother was from Grapevine. She's one of the coaches. And we eventually moved over there, and I went to elementary school in a two-room schoolhouse, Grapevine.
And what grades was that?
First through seventh.
And then at the seventh, did you go on to the school on the island?
I started at Mars Hill and didn't like it.
Oh, okay.
But then I transferred to Marshall and graduated there.
And the school at that time was on the island,
wasn't
it?
It was on the island.
It was still on the island. When you and I came here to work, it was still on the island.
Mm-hmm.
I remember taking students over there to do a play at one point and being so surprised, thinking that, you know, in flood time, you were desperate. There was no way either to get on or off if the weather was really bad or the water was really bad. You mentioned Berea, you and I have talked about Berea before, and I know that must have been a huge decision for you, because in those days, getting to Berea was like going to China. There were no interstate roads. And
right.
How did you decide to go to Berea?
Well, I credit one of my teachers, because when I was in school, there was no guidance counselors. But I don't know if you ever knew Roy Reeves in
no.
Marshall. He was my business teacher, I think. And he grew up on Shelton Laurel. And he saw potential in me and encouraged me to go to Berea.
And how much did you know? Had you been there to visit? Or
no.
You just went cold turkey?
Went cold turkey. I was accepted in April.
Right.
And my uncle, who used to work here, Ernest Coates, he was a head painter for
right.
years. He and his wife took me to Berea, first time I'd ever been there.
So, well, you know, Virginia Hart tells a similar thing about coming to Mars Hill. She'd never been here before she actually went as a mm-hmm. student. I, that's very hard to believe that, you know, you would go to a place and know that it was going to be the right place. Were you immediately impressed when you got there that it was a place you needed to be?
Not really. I was homesick.
Yes.
You know, because I'd never been off Grapevine, basically.
That's a long way to go.
But after about 3 weeks,
it was okay.
I enjoyed it and I loved it. And I mean, I still love it.
they'll learn.
It changed my life, I'm sure.
I have read so much about Berea, and I first became aware of Berea when I was in college. Because of the nature of the school, talk a little bit about what was required of the students there that's different from every other place.
Okay, every student must work at least 10 hours a week in order to be there.
Right.
And the guidelines for the parents' salary is, you know, because it's intended for the poorer students in the Appalachian region mainly. And everybody was equal. You know, there were no rich kids, poor kids. We were all equal. We worked 10 hours a week.
What was the job or jobs that you had?
My first job was working in the cafeteria, breakfast.
Oh, how was that? You had to get up early to get up.
I had to get up about 5:30, which I didn't care for, you know, but I did that. And then once I went into the nursing program, we worked in the hospital.
So you actually began nursing training in Berea then. Was that what would be equivalent to a major at that point?
It was.
Mm-hmm. So you knew very early on that you wanted to be a nurse.
Well, it took me a year. Okay. I went for a year without thinking, and then I went into the nursing programs.
Okay. When you were in the nursing program, where did you all do your, what hospital did you work in as your?
Well, our first 3 years, we worked in Berea.
In Berea.
And then our third year, we, first 2 years of Berea, then our third year was the University of Cincinnati.
Oh.
And that was a culture shock.
I'll
going
bet.
From a school of 1,500 to 20,000.
Ooh.
But it was a great learning experience.
When you actually went then to Cincinnati, where did they place you? What was the avenue of your training? Do you go in, obviously you're at sort of an intern level to get your beginning work. How did that work?
Well, there we had OB, pediatrics and psychiatry, which was not offered at Berea.
I see.
And the higher level courses.
Did you find those courses hard?
Yeah, I did.
but clearly you were challenged.
But it was a challenge.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the best teachers I ever had were there. I mean, they really expected you to know as much as the med students. This one particular teacher, for example.
So you feel basically you got a great education.
Mm-hmm. And I was in the third year program of the bachelor program at
okay.
Berea.
After to become fully certified, what level of certification were you as a nurse when you began your work? Is it a registered nurse or?
Well, you have to be registered.
Registered.
And plus I had a BSN, which in those days was equivalent to a master's now, you know.
So you really got, through your two experiences in Berea and in Cincinnati, mm-hmm. a great background for the work that you ultimately were going to do. One of the things I've read about Berea is, now, with the understanding that everybody works 10 hours a week, was there also a tuition grant in that? Did you have to pay?
There was free tuition.
Free tuition.
All you paid was room and board.
Room and board.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And your work study money that you were went toward that.
Yes.
So
it was a good deal for everybody.
My first year, my bill was $64.
And I bet, really, when you think about it, that represented a fair amount of money even mm-hmm. then.
And then when I was a sophomore, I was lucky enough to get a scholarship that paid everything until I graduated.
Until you graduated. Mm-hmm. What a wonderful story. How lovely for that to happen to you at the point where probably for all of us in school, money was a big deal mm-hmm. to get through college. I read somewhere recently, and you would probably know this, that among the universities and colleges in the United States, that Berea is one of the most heavily endowed schools in the country.
It is.
And I was surprised when I read that, and then I thought, oh, that's logical, because individuals and corporations really appreciate the work ethic, and they want to support that program. Is it still free tuition to go there?
Yes, mm-hmm. It is. Still room and board.
Is it very hard to get in nowadays because of?
It's kind of hard. You have to make good grades.
Keep up. Yeah. Do you go back for reunions occasionally?
I do. In fact, I'm looking forward to my 50th in 2012.
Oh, so you're going to go back. Great, great.
Get to eat with the president, you know that.
That sort of thing.
Well, I've gone back frequently.
Good. Yeah. When you left and you had gotten your degree in hand, you said you met Bert, your husband, mm-hmm. at Berea. What was he studying at the time?
He said he went into history major. I actually met him when I was in public health, because we had a whole semester out in one of the eastern counties.
Okay.
And that's where I actually met him. And then he came to Berea and started school.
And did you all marry as soon as you got your degree?
We married in August after I got my degree.
And then you mentioned Florida. Did you go directly to Florida from
No, we lived 5 years in Kentucky. And he worked in computer, the first computer I ever saw. And it was longer than one of those tables.
Yes.
That's what he did then. And then we decided to move to Florida. We lived down there 5 years.
So you really were nursing in both places during that time?
I did part-time, because by this time we had two children.
That's right, yeah. And talk about the boys. I know it, Brian and Brad. I had to think of his name. Yes. And they are still in the area, too, in Mars Hill, aren't they?
Right. As a matter of fact, Brad and his wife, Laura, work at the college.
Yes.
And Brian's wife is graduating senior at the college. And Brian's still here. He works in construction. So
everybody. And you have a
sister. Brian went to Mars Hill.
And you have a sister here who's still working.
Half my family.
And Nathan Harmon also.
Nathan's my brother.
Your brother. And he was here. Although he's retired now, I believe.
He is. Mm-hmm.
So this place has Mars Hill as both a town and a college. Has a very important part in your life and the whole family. When you came here in 1973, Dr. Duck was the medical director. What were your first duties? What was assigned to you first?
To learn the place, I had one day of orientation by the nurse that was leaving. And basically to take care of the students when they walked in. It's like a walk-in clinic type thing. And I had a wonderful person who worked as combination CNA, Pauline Ramsey. And she helped me tremendously that year because she knew where everything was and I didn't. But there was a lot of disorganization when I came here because there had been a lot of nurses that would come and stay while they were in school and then they'd leave and there was no real organization. And of course, Dr. Duck at the time was in his office most of the time, you know.
In his
and
office?
He only came, he and Dr. the pals came right. 4 days a week for an hour. So.
And tell me the names of the pals. I know who
Charles and Ernest.
Charles and Ernest. And mm-hmm. They came to the clinic. They were all here checking in each day.
They would make rounds for an hour a day to right. see the students rather than have to right. send them to their office.
If I remember correctly, when I went to college, I had to do a medical form that was a part of my application. Was that your responsibility to keep up with all those medical forms?
It was.
And know the medical history of students?
It was, especially the athletes, because you know, and it's much stricter now than it was then. When I first came here, immunizations weren't required. But now the state mandates certain immunizations, so those are.
In the time that you were here, did you find, you mentioned the athletic program. Did you find that you had lots of athletic injuries to deal with that came to the infirmary?
We did, because when I came here, there was no training room. There was a student trainer
right.
who learned on the job, and we did most of the athletic injuries. Dr. Duck would send the ones that needed further attention into Asheville.
Right.
So.
Was there a plan, for example, if someone came into you with an athletic injury or any kind of injury that was not something that you could handle, did that person, did he go to the clinic across town where Dr. Duck was and then to the hospital? Was that the avenue or did Dr. Duck come over?
Well, it would depend on the time of the injury. If it was, you know, something that would wait overnight, he would see him the next morning when he made rounds.
Right.
If it was more of an emergency type thing, he would see him. After hours, he would come to the infirmary because we had nurses around the clock. Because he always felt if he could do something in the infirmary, it might save the student paying a big hospital bill.
Right, right.
Plus, they had no transportation.
That's true.
Most of them didn't.
Most, and in those early days, although during part of the time when you and I were here early on, there was a bus going back and forth at least once a day, but most, if you didn't have a car, you were really up the creek
right.
here. I remember when I first came here, there was a sense that the infirmary served kind of like a ward, because you'd have several students who were ill, and I remember going over to visit some of my students in the infirmary. Does that still exist today, that kind of feeling that people stay overnight there?
No, because there's no coverage at night.
I see.
The hours are Monday through Friday, 7 to 3, or I think, something like that.
When did all that change?
The year I retired, they cut out the weekend shift, because we were open 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And they cut out the weekend shift because they felt like they could afford to do that. Most kids leave. You know.
Yeah.
And then the next year, they cut out the evening shift. The night shift. The weekends came first, then they cut out the night shift. And then they had two nurses. One worked 3 to 11, and then the day nurse.
So essentially today, the infirmary exists somewhat like an office job. We're in from like 7 to 3, 4, something like
three.
That.
And I think Leslie Anderson's nurse is there now. Probably her biggest job is taking care of immunizations, making sure they're up to date and this kind of stuff. The doctor still makes rounds.
Right.
But when I first came here, we did a lot of things. We did IVs, we did, you know, allergy shots and all this, and all that's no longer.
That's no longer a part of it. I remember when, during part of the time I was here, you also gave flu shots.
I did.
Because the faculty I know were getting their flu shots there. And I remember several times going to visit students who had developed like mono, for example, and you kept them.
We've kept them a week at a time.
Yes.
And a couple of patients we had 6 weeks. One boy had had actually broken his back sledding over on Gibson Hill, and he was in the infirmary for 6 weeks. And then another student had to have IV medicines through a central line, so we kept him.
This means you are also having to deal with being certain that the cafeteria gets traced up for all of these.
Right.
So that becomes a huge undertaking for you.
Well, we were lucky enough to have student assistants, and that was part of their duties, was to go
to the cafeteria.
Go to the cafeteria. And interesting thing, most of the time you got 10 or 12 kids fed, the food would be cold. So I said one day to Dr. Duck, I said, I wish we had a microwave so we could heat the food.
Of course.
So about 2 hours later, he called and he said, if somebody can go to Sears, I've ordered you a microwave. That was our first microwave.
That was the first one. Yeah. You just have to let people know what you need.
Oh, yeah.
It magically appears. That's great. During the time you were in the infirmary as a nurse, did you ever have, what were any outbreaks of stuff where you had quarantine situations?
Well, the minor things would be the flu. We would restrict visitors for that to keep the kids from spreading.
Right.
But we had that one major episode where we treated over 1,000 students 1 week.
What was the problem?
It was some kind of viral syndrome. The kids had the usual nausea, vomiting, dehydration, and this. And the dorms were full of them because we didn't have room for them. We had a student to die that week, and indirectly from that, because he had stayed in the dorm and became too dehydrated, and he had an underlying heart problem, so that just weakened him.
Let me ask you about that question of student deaths. It was always very difficult for me during the time I taught. You and I, our times here overlap almost exactly. I came in 71 and left in 97, and you came in 73 and left in 99. I lost three students to death during that period, and it was very, very difficult. One was murdered. You probably remember Sally Moffitt.
That was my first year.
Mm-hmm. I don't think that case was ever solved. Then I had a student who died of a heart attack running down from the dormitory to the bookstore.
Well, I remember that vividly.
Were you a part of that?
No, I was just getting ready to leave, and a nurse named Betsy Hill was coming on duty, and we got the call that his name was Thomas.
Yes.
I can't remember his last name.
I'm not sure. I remember.
Had collapsed in front of the bookstore, so
yes.
Betsy ran down there, and Dr. Duck happened to be eating in the dining room that night, so he went over there, and they did CPR, the ambulance came, took him to the hospital, and he never made it.
He was a charming student. He was, I was working with him on an independent study at that time, and it was devastating, you know, to see such a young life snuffed out. And then I had one other student who died on the way down to Mars Hill at an overlook. He fell off an overlook and was killed on his way down to the college. It didn't happen on campus. What was the infirmary's responsibility to the college in cases of those deaths? What did the college have to do?
Well, Dr. Duck mainly dealt with it. You know, he dealt with getting the parents notified, and with the Moffitt case, there was a lot of legal in fact, as far as the infirmary was concerned, the only thing he called to get her, like her birth date and all that stuff.
Right.
Since it happened, you know, I mean,
away.
Since she was found off campus,
right.
I really didn't know.
But I can remember, I can only imagine what that must have been like when the student died right here on campus and mm-hmm. you had to deal with that. You were still on campus too when the young Japanese student hanged himself.
That was very traumatic. I remember his little girlfriend was so distraught, and she came to the infirmary. Dr. Duck came and talked to her. The Parkers,
I do remember them.
Harriet
and Calvin.
They
had served
missionaries.
That's right.
So they came and tried to work with her. But it just affected a lot of the students. The campus police, Thomas, that was working at the time, that was hard for him.
Hard. I'm sure it was hard for him. I remember the memorial service for that young man was very, very difficult for Dr. Bentley, because his family had come from Japan, and it was very difficult. The cultural differences made it very complicated. When you came to the infirmary, I looked it up. The infirmary was built in 1935, and it's still there, looking pretty much like it's looked all those years. It seems to me, even when I first went into it all those years ago, that it was kind of dated. Was that always the case? Did you feel it was inadequate, really, as a building that you should work in as a medical technician?
It was. I mean, like, for example, when we would do athletic physicals, we'd have a doctor in one room, a doctor in another room, but we only had one sink. And you know, it's nice to wash your hands between patients.
Of course.
So
that was awkward.
There was, you know, but when it was built, I'm sure that was
probably adequate in those days. Mm-hmm. And it was named after a well-known doctor here. I looked him up, and
W.F. Robinson.
Yes, W.F. Yes, and he apparently was quite a person in the community.
He was the greatest donor, I mean, as far as amount. Do you know how much he gave in order to get his name on the building?
It was like 10.
2,500.
Was it?
2,500.
Yes, I remember reading that. It was, at the time, of course, the whole building didn't cost but what, 10 or 12, something like that.
A lot of them gave $1, a lot of the churches.
Yes.
And that list is still up there. Yes.
So the building, while primitive, has served very well all that period of time. Have there been any major upgrades in there?
I think they did mostly renovating inside since I left. I know they did upstairs. And the counseling center, which used to be in the student union, was moved up there, which
good.
I think is
good.
Where it should be.
Should be, you're right.
So, but basically it's still...
Still the same.
Still the same.
I remember vividly when, in 1978, when Susan King was here on campus to do the Bell of Amherst, she didn't have anywhere to stay. And she ended up staying in a room in the infirmary. And she always tells me, she says, now when you see Ellen, remind her of the time that the Bell of Amherst stayed over in the infirmary. So it became a dormitory in that sense.
It did, and we enjoyed it. She, you know, practiced. But now, a couple of years when we had a large enrollment, we literally did have students in that, the upstairs, the whole length toward Blackwell is one long ward. And we had students, girls to live in there. And I felt bad for them because they had one bathroom.
Oh yeah.
And the only place they had to store stuff was under their bed. But they took it in stride.
Took it in stride.
You know.
Well, it's certainly, it's architecturally on the campus, it's fascinating to see it sort of stuck in the middle of all some modern buildings and then some old buildings. It still has charm as far as its look.
When we talk about the building,
yes.
Did you know that Joe
the slave?
His original tombstone is in that building.
I did not.
I didn't either until Jim Fish tried to point it out to me one day. It's facing black. Well, it's one of those stones there.
On the front?
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you told me that. In the time that you were there, what would you say was the most trying or difficult thing you had to deal with on a consistent basis?
Can I be honest?
Be honest.
Students trying to get out of class.
And so they'd come to get excuses kind of thing?
They did. And when I came there, they could come 2 days later if they'd missed class and get a note. And I finally worked with Earl Leininger and explained to him, you know, this is being abused, and I don't mind if they're sick to give them an excuse, but they must come before they miss the class.
Yes.
And that helped.
It solved it. I remember vividly a young woman bringing me an excuse that you had signed, and she hadn't figured out she had copied your signature on 4 or 5 days that she wasn't there. And it was clear that it was a copy, you know. You could just put the copies over and it was good. And I remember thinking, oh, I hope Ellen doesn't know her name is being used in this way. One of the things I shall always treasure as a memory was not a happy experience, but I shall always remember feeling so grateful that you were here. Very soon after I first came here, I had a young student to have an epileptic seizure in class. And it was at that time in the Moore Auditorium building in the classroom downstairs. And I sent somebody over immediately to get you. And in no time, you were there taking charge of the situation. And I remember thinking at the time, I have a great education, but nobody ever told me that I had to deal with these emergencies in a class. And you were there taking care of it immediately. And with a very professional ease so that the students around felt that this young woman who had had the seizure was in good hands. Did you have a lot of that kind of thing?
We did. I've gone up to Gibson for, we had a student that had a seizure one morning, and I started walking and called security to pick me up, and by the time I got up there, they finally arrived.
Yeah.
And Dr. Bentley met me there. He had heard it too, but we had that. We'd have falls that we'd have to go help, you know, make sure they were moved right and this kind of stuff. I remember we carried a girl out of Stroop down those narrow stairs. She had fallen, she had broken her back, and we literally carried her on a stretcher down those narrow steps because there was no elevator.
No elevator, right.
And there were, you know, in the gym, I remember vividly when the student got hurt, Buddy Barris, I don't know if you remember Buddy.
No.
He was a gymnast and he landed wrong and everybody thought he'd broken his neck, but he hadn't, but you know, things like that.
So you had a lot of that sort of thing. Did the faculty come and see your services often?
Well, they always came for the flu vaccine,
right.
and a few years we had the wellness fair, and they attended that. And some would come, you know, some would come just to ask questions, some, you know. And I enjoyed, you know, I know our limits as far as being able to take care of them because we had no medical records on them, this kind of stuff. And I gave them allergy shots till the Hot Springs Health Program came, and then they wouldn't let us do that. The one I remember vividly was Jim Lindbergh when he came his freshman year. Excuse me.
He came the first year, the same year you did.
He came, and he was young looking, you know, and he came in that morning. I don't know what was wrong with him, and I told him to come back to see the doctor. So at 12:30 when they came back, the doctor used to come at 12:30. And I said, Jim, I can't find a folder on you. And he said, could it be because I'm a teacher?
Yes.
Because I thought he looked as young as the students.
I mean, he loved that, didn't he?
Yeah, we always liked
that. Oh, goodness, that's funny. What do you think was the worst case you ever had over there, the thing that was the most difficult for you to deal with?
You mean as far as illness?
Uh-huh.
Goodness. Probably the girl that walked in one day and said, I can't breathe good. And I put her to bed, took her vital signs. She was definitely in shock. called the doctor. He said, get her to the emergency room. And she died that night with a dissecting aneurysm.
Oh, my goodness.
She had Marfan syndrome.
And how do you spell that word? I don't know that word.
M-A-R-F-A-N.
And what is it? What is the problem with it?
Literally, they grow too fast, and their aorta doesn't grow to keep up with it.
So, but you didn't know she had this condition when
no,
she
had. No, I had no idea, because she was transferred from Brevard. It's when Pat Sams was basketball coach,
yes,
and she was going to play basketball for him.
What a terrible, terrible scenario.
It was.
You mentioned the wellness program. When did that come into being, and was that something you originated, and how'd that work?
Dr. Duck and I together decided that it would be something we could offer to the faculty and staff, because
right.
we felt like we needed to offer them more. So we got a lab out of Asheville to do the lab work, and you know, I can't remember all the things we did, but we had it before, like early in the morning, and the faculty and staff would come in, we'd do a wellness screening, and I'm not sure if we gave, I don't think we updated their boosters or anything. It's been a few years.
So it really worked while it was going. Why did it end, do you think?
I left.
You left. And it was not continued after you left.
Yeah.
Well, that's disappointing to know you still.
Well, and when Dr. Duck died, I didn't have as much support.
Right. Did you find it difficult to take over, because you became medical director just shortly after he died? Did you find that, because of his longevity here, that it was difficult for you to get the same kinds of attention from the administration that he had been able to get just by being here for so long?
Not the administration. It was difficult working with the new medical group.
And by then that was Hot Springs program.
Right. Mm-hmm. They really did not want us to do anything except over-the-counter drugs and basically, you know, things. They didn't want us to do anything that they could do in their office.
Was that an issue of liability, or was that turf control?
Probably both. Because, and there was some, you know, when they first took over, there was a little bit of a strain between the two, even when Dr. Duck was still living.
Still living.
But we were able, and some of the doctors I love to this day, you know, that's in that group. But I think it was the administration trying to get all the legalities worked out.
Right. Well, of course, his approach, he had been a family, a good old country doctor in a way, had been probably a whole lot more informal than a group that comes in from the outside that brings in young doctors.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, that's going to be if not anything, mostly a generational thing.
Mm-hmm.
And probably then medical requirements with regard to liability and all that were very different too, probably, mm-hmm. weren't they, later on?
And then, you know, PAs and nurse practitioners,
yes.
weren't as popular as they are now. And he felt like that if he did not somehow keep control of the infirmary through me,
right.
That the new group would send like a nurse practitioner over there, and that would be it. And he
right.
felt like we had an unwritten contract with every parent that we would provide medical care to their students when they were sent here. I mean, that was just an unwritten law as far as he was concerned.
But very important, and probably the other organization would not have had that sort of feeling, because they didn't have a direct contact with the
right.
students in the same
right.
way Dr. Duck did. Talk a little bit about him. He was an incredible human being. Talk about your experiences in working with him.
I have to say he's the best teacher I ever had, and even more so than my nursing teachers, because he felt like every day he came to the infirmary that he should teach me and or the other nurses something. In fact, one time one of the nurses didn't know what a particular instrument was, and he didn't say anything to her, but he called me at home and he said, you know, we really need to teach them all we can before they leave here, you know, over a simple instrument.
Right.
And he was so good to the nurses. He never yelled, he never raised his voice, but he loved to teach. and he would take special time. When we had the mini mustard,
do you remember
the mini mustard?
Right.
Two or three of my student assistants that were going into nursing later would take a mini mustard course, and he would precept them. And with the patient's permission, he would have that student in there, because it gets a little touchy, students in with students. And he would spend extra time just teaching that student, you know.
And that was a gift he gave, because it was really not required of him to
do. Well, he loved teaching. I mean, that was one of them. And he could diagnose almost anything.
So that was a very special skill of his as a doctor. He could tell pretty quickly what the problem was.
He could.
And that must be a gift. I mean, you've got all the technical things you can use to determine that, but he was intuitive a lot, wasn't he?
He was. I had a stress fracture in my foot one time, and he knew that's what it was. I mean, he said, I can tell you that's what it is. But my husband was working evening, so he said, I'm just going to run you up to the emergency room and get an x-ray. So when he got there, the young resident said, did you bring any x-rays to compare them with? You know, and he said, no, but I can tell you it's a stress fracture. And there it was.
And there it was. Yeah. So he knew.
Through his experience. And he had a lot of experience, you know, during World War II. He didn't elaborate on that, but he wrote the history of that, and you may have read it at some time.
I did not. Tell me about that.
Well, he was a MASH officer in World War II.
Where was he stationed?
In Germany, Belgium, maybe.
Okay.
It's in Peggy's section of the...
Okay.
Because I gave it to her after he passed
away. So it's down in the Appalachian archives of the college.
Right. But he didn't talk about that a lot. I think, you know, death was something I'm sure he didn't enjoy having to deal with.
No. He often said to me, when we were talking informally about the number of babies that he had brought into the world, it was several thousand, he said, and he always talked about that in a very positive, upbeat way, and in the sense that often the circumstances would be so meager and so bad, because the hospitals, he would have to travel to places, and he was talking about how lucky he was not to have lost very many children, I think.
And he never had a maternal death. In all the years
that
they delivered, he told me they never had a mother to die. But he could tell some good stories about delivering babies. You know?
Did he do that a lot? Did he talk about those kinds of things?
Oh, yeah. He enjoyed it. There was one, if I could tell you, he went to Marshall to deliver. He got a call, and he did a lot of home deliveries. And he got there, and he said, I saw the woman was not in labor. It was just probably false labor. And he told her husband, she may go into full labor tomorrow. If she does, call me and I'll come back. And at that point, the man took a gun down off the gun rack and said, you're not going anywhere. And he held him at gunpoint all night in case that mother delivered.
Oh, golly. And did the baby come the next day?
No. He finally let him go, I think, the next day.
He finally understood it.
And another one, because he delivered in some of the poorest sections, well, this whole county, and even Buncombe, and over Black Pond, Tennessee, and over in that way. But the one that always, that touched me, he said he went into a home one time, and it was so cold that when the mother was delivering, her body fluids warmed his hands. They were so cold.
So cold.
So
I wonder if he ever wrote any of these memoirs. Do you know if he wrote it?
Yes, he did.
About these?
He did.
Do they exist somewhere?
They do. In that same...
They're in that same collection.
Yeah, I made a notebook. I collected all his... Because back then we didn't, you know, there was no computers to speak of.
Right.
And so I volunteered to type all his stuff for him. And I kept a copy, and I made it in a notebook for him and gave it to him at Christmas.
Were they vignette stories like the one you just told, or were they, what was the focus primarily?
Well, the one about his war experiences was probably the largest one. And then he did the one, it's called The Life of a Country Doctor, and he presented that several times. He did that at Grove Park Inn. With a Southern OBGYN seminar that he was the first president of.
And that he was not,
an OBGYN doctor.
That must have been a huge honor for him.
Oh, it was. And he dearly loved that organization.
Right. And MAHEC, I know, is another organization mm-hmm. that dearly loved him because he was very much a part of that, too.
He was president of MAHEC for 4 years.
Yes, I remember. Yeah. I didn't remember that it was 4 years, mm-hmm. but everywhere I would go around Asheville and mention his name, he was revered in the most incredible way. Mm-hmm. So in the memories that he wrote, was there any attempt ever to publish those? Did he ever want to publish them?
I don't think so. I think he more or less wanted them for his family and you know, for the people that knew him, like
right.
the college, because he loved this college, you know.
So much. Did Dr. Duck ever talk about his daughter Linda much? Because she had a physical condition that was not something he could cure. It must have been very difficult for him to know that he was a medical person and not able to help his own daughter.
I think he explored every avenue to try to find help for her when she was little. That was before I knew him, because I remember he told me he took her to Texas, you know, to the heart center that was out there then. And but he was always so proud of her, because even though she had a very serious problem, she graduated from here,
yes,
went on and got 2 masters. And he always loved to tell about how she cheerleaded, even though she didn't actually do, you know, she didn't yell and scream like the rest of them did.
She was a theater major, of course, and I got to know her that way. Mm-hmm. And I was always very aware that of her health being an issue, but that she was never going to let that stop her,
mm-hmm. she
you
didn't.
Know, from doing what everybody else did. Mm-hmm. And she was a fine actress and a storyteller and a writer.
And I loved her and her puppets.
Yes, she was very, very gifted. I remember she went to University of Georgia to do one of those graduate degrees and made a big name for herself there because of those skills that she had. But I often thought about Otis and how difficult it must have been for him.
I'm sure it was.
Knowing he couldn't help her.
The thing about Georgia, one of the physicians that he knew at this seminar we just mentioned knew Linda quite well. She had a morning TV show for children with her puppets. And even after Linda left, they still used them. And that always made Dr. Duck proud.
So she had started something that continued long mm-hmm. after she left
right.
it. Good. I remember her vividly when she came here in 2000 to honor Jim Thomas when he retired. Because they were good friends and good mm-hmm. buddies all those years. And had lots of nice things to say about the years when she was here as a student. If you could have changed anything about your work in the infirmary or the infirmary itself, what would you have wanted to do first?
Probably have more modern equipment, but I knew that was probably something that wasn't feasible with the budget and everything.
Right.
You know.
Do you think that the college today will ever move in that direction?
Probably not, because most colleges are getting away, unless they're a large university, you know, and have a teaching
right.
hospital or something. I can see in the future that the infirmary could actually be outsourced, you know. Basically, the immunizations is something that a medical person would not necessarily have to be the one to do it.
Right.
You know?
So if a town had a local clinic, there could be a relationship
right.
with a college or university and the local clinic to handle
right.
medical issues. Has there ever been any discussion of having a nursing program on campus?
There may have been. I think years ago, Joanne Kroom may have looked into it. When I came here, the nurses that staffed the infirmary were coming back to work on a degree. Now, it didn't have to be a degree in nursing or... As a matter of fact, I had one that majored in psychology, one that majored in history, and then they worked for us. It was
right.
free labor, basically, you know.
Right.
But they got free tuition for doing it. And I talked to Joanne why we couldn't take those nurses and let them work for a BSN in nursing, and
right.
she said because the facilities for the nursing experience was not on the campus.
Okay. I know that at Gardner Webb, for example, the nursing program was a hugely successful, and still is.
It still is.
A very successful program. And they pride themselves on not only the quality of that work, but the number of students they graduated. It seemed to me logical, you know, with the science faculty that we had here, that was a good basis for a program.
It would have been.
But it's the facility that they would have had to use.
Right.
That doesn't, it's not provided. That makes sense. It's interesting, and at the same time, it seems to me with somebody like you and Dr. Duck, you would have been the logical persons to...
Well, you know, possibly it could have been done through Mission Hospital, like AB Tech.
Right.
AB Tech, you know, affiliates with Mission Hospital,
yes,
and they get their clinical experience at the hospital and other places too. But
have you done any work at all with AB Tech?
Not
directly.
Other than take some computer classes personally.
But not anything with a nursing program.
No.
I know that even though you retired all those years ago, well, not all that many years ago, but how soon did you discover that you were not going to be able to be retired? Because I know you're going back and working now at Memorial Mission on weekends, even today.
I stayed home for 2 years.
Was that enough to drive you crazy?
Well, drive Bert crazy, maybe. But I enjoyed it, and I went back thinking I'd work maybe a year or so, and I'm in my ninth year working on the St. Joseph campus.
And what do you do at St. Joseph?
I'm on the medical floor, and we do everything. It's a busy floor.
And do you work like a day shift or a night shift?
I work two 12-hour shifts.
Is that hard, Ellen, working 12-hour shifts?
No, it's better than eight because you have more time to get your work done.
Ah, okay.
And then you go home.
And you're still challenged.
Oh, yes, yes. The type of patients we have now just out on the floor are sicker than the ones that I took care of in my early nursing when I worked a critical unit.
Why is that?
People living longer and medicine is more advanced, I think.
Oh, okay. Do you find that you have more senior patients in that configuration now?
On our floor particularly, we're adult medicine and we're the diabetic floor also, so we get a lot of older patients.
How much have you had to do in terms of your own study to keep up with all these new things that have happened in the computer age? Have you had to do a lot of new studying?
Oh, yes. Computer, and when I went to the hospital, everything is computerized.
Yes.
At the hospital.
Yeah.
But I will say for the hospital, they have a wonderful education department, and they really want their nurses educated. They mandate it, you know.
So you go to classes?
You go to required classes when anything new comes up.
Good.
When you go in as a new nurse, not a new graduate, but I mean somebody with 30 years experience, still gets 12 weeks of being precepted by nurses there on the floor.
How'd you feel when you went through that program?
I felt lost because when I went there, I had never used, for example, an IV pump.
Ah.
I mean, we didn't.
You didn't have a need for that.
No. And when we did, we counted the drops.
Yeah.
But there, it's all machine, you know.
Did you find it stressful to go into that new stuff?
Very much so. Yeah, I did. To the point I thought I'm making a mistake, that I had a couple of good preceptors.
And they stayed with you?
They stayed with me.
Good. Do you notice a difference when you go back, for example, you have had a long career in doing this, and there are probably many younger nurses on staff around you. Do you feel any sense that there is a perception that they look up to you because of your long experience? Are you asked questions
mm-hmm.
by the younger nurses?
Mm-hmm. Quite often.
So you feel a sense of their respect for your longevity in the field?
I do, and I always try to help. I mean, if I see a situation that I think I can, you know, give them a little more insight into something.
You're doing Dr. Duck.
So, well, he was a good teacher.
Yeah, so he taught you well.
Yeah.
To teach. How has it been, when you were starting out as a nurse in your training, I bet you there weren't any men in the nursing classes,
no,
were there?
Very few.
And I'm sure that now on the floor where you work, there are many young, many nurses who are men. Mm-hmm. Has that changed the field of nursing?
I think it has, and I think for the better, you know, because men deal with certain patients better than women do. Of course, a lot of the older patients, they think they're doctors, so they get better results with them than they would with me, for example. But
how do you handle that as a woman? Is that, does that make you unhappy, or does that bother?
No, it's fine with me. I work with some great male nurses, some of the best.
I'm aware of that perception that for many older people, there were doctors who were male in their mm-hmm. history, and so they gravitate to a doctor, or rather a nurse who is a male. In your experience, have you noticed any change, for example, at Mars Hill's clinic here in town, most of the doctors there are women. And for some of the older men dealing with women as doctors, have you noticed that dynamic at all? Has that been?
In the hospital, I see it not so much from the men, but women, we have certain women patients that will request not to have a male nurse.
Okay.
The reason I was told by one of the physicians here in Mars Hill that they have so many women doctors is most of them work part-time.
I see.
And they can afford to do that.
Right.
Whereas the men can, apparently.
So there's a difference, the perception then, mm-hmm. because of commitment to career, maybe.
Right.
A longevity of hours, right. a longness of hours.
But we have some great female nurses, doctors at the hospital.
Great.
We do.
And I know that the nurses here in town, or rather the doctors here in town who are female, have their own respect coming from the local people. And that probably has been something that's had to grow, because that was not true in Dr. Duck's era.
Right.
Yeah. In all of this time, I know something about you which probably most people don't know. And that's that you have been a surrogate mother to a lot of people over the years. People who found you, or maybe you found, as someone that you could mentor, someone who needed attention. In fact, you and I were talking about Melody Hogan recently, and I happened to know her when she was here as a student, and I did not know until she mentioned it that you had been like a surrogate mother to mm-hmm. her. What was it in your makeup that made you become mother hen to a lot of people who?
I don't know, but Charles Powell told me I was a surrogate mother to all these students. I said, please. But the way I got to know Melody, she was doing a mini-mester thing at Veterans, and she came into the infirmary looking for medical information. And she and I got to talking, then she'd just come and hang out in the infirmary. And then there were a couple more, but over the years we called it adopted them, you know, and they'd go to church with us, they'd come and play with the kids, you know, they'd come and eat with us and this kind of stuff. And Tom Everett, I don't know if you knew Tom Everett, I think he was a history English major or something. And Tom always told us that we had the greatest influence on him besides his football coach. He said, if it hadn't been for people like you and Bird, I probably would have wound up in jail, because he didn't have a good home life. And he was very honest about it. And he loved Bert because of Bert's love of reading. And at Bert's memorial service, Tom talked about that, which I didn't even realize, that because Bert had discussed books with him, he said nobody had ever done that before. So
both of you then became surrogate parents to a lot of people.
Because we were in our early 30s when we came here.
Yeah.
And it just, you know, it just seemed natural.
Right.
And certain students, you know, I think need that mother figure away from home.
You know? Also, you provided stability, because anybody who came to see you was already vulnerable. They came into mm-hmm. the infirm and needing help, and you were there to give them the kind of help. One of the things I've always admired about you in my relationship with you has been the directness in a positive way. It was, you know, you were professional in dealing with things, and it's getting to the issues at hand. And I used to think, golly, when you're dealing with students, I think about you're dealing with students, they must have felt very secure, because you were right there dealing with them in a very secure and very special way. There was not a, you told it like it was, in other words, and they needed to hear that. Are you aware of having that quality about yourself?
I'm pretty blunt. But well, I believe in, I mean, I believe in being tactful, but I believe in telling things the way they should be. I mean, the way it is, you know, I'm just that way. And
do you have that problem sometimes when you're dealing with a medical issue where you think the patient is not ready to handle all bad news? Are you, is that something that is tricky for you?
It is. Mm-hmm. I had a student one time, and I'm sure this is nothing new. She found out she was pregnant. And I had the joy of telling her, because the doctor said, Dr. Collins said, you go ahead and tell her. You know, her test was positive. So I called her and the boyfriend in, and they were a lovely couple. I mean, just sweet as they could be. And my first reaction, I mean, when I told her, she said, how could he do that to me? And I thought, wait a minute. Talking about the boyfriend, the doctor, who are you talking about?
Yeah.
And I said, who? And she said, God. And that really, I really had to, you know, sturdy myself not to say something. Because I didn't judge him. I mean, you know. And I just let her talk. And I never let them know what my opinion was about abortion or anything. I would give them the facts, and I never tried to influence them either way. But I was there, you know, if they needed to talk to me or something like that.
Good. But so you had to be, in many ways, the parent that they didn't have here on campus, and that was a good example of it. I know that you and Bert enjoyed your outings and travels up and down the Blue Ridge Parkway, for example. What did you enjoy most for fun? I can't figure out when you had time for fun. You were raising a family and working. But when you all did fun activities, what sort of things did you do?
Well, we loved to go out on the up the parkway up into Virginia. We loved the Outer Banks. And he loved football. I got to like football. We tried to go to most of our games here on campus. And we go the away games. And then he watch it at home. So.
Right.
But just as long as we were doing things together, basically.
That was the important thing.
Yeah.
You got to work with Dick Hoffman and Fred Bentley, and probably less so with Dr. Lennon, because you were retired during his term. Mm-hmm. What are your impressions and memories of Dr. Hoffman?
I thought he was the most gentle-spoken person. Just, I never saw him. I don't think I ever saw him get angry. He was just, I always thought of him as just being at peace with himself. And he it seemed to portray that when he dealt with other people.
Did you deal with him more than you dealt with Dr. Bentley, or was it?
Probably not. Dr. Bentley, by the way, I didn't meet him formally till I'd been here 3 years.
Really? How'd that happen?
Dean Gehring thought I didn't need to meet him, I guess.
Okay.
But I'll never forget the first time he called me on the phone. I thought, oh my gosh, what a voice. I loved his voice.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
But I found Dr. Bentley to be very, just very kind and supportive. And I worked with Earl Leininger. He was, you know, I guess he was after, was he after Dick?
That's right, he was.
I worked with him quite a bit.
Good. So you got to see the administration, and did you feel that they supported what you did?
Oh, yes.
They were there when you needed them.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that Dr. Bentley had met you at the dormitory in the case of the young student who was, mm-hmm. did you encounter that kind of personal involvement in administration in general, where they were equally concerned and were there when you needed?
I think they were.
Mm-hmm. That's
the ones that were here when I came here. In fact, Dean Gehring told me, if you need anything, the first year, I probably bugged the business office to death, because Dean Gehring said, now if you need anything, just call Violet Henderson, and she'll be able to help you. And basically, than Dean Gehring, that's who I called.
Right.
You know, I was brand new at the job. I'd never, you know, that type of nursing. I'd always been in acute care, you know, emergency room, critical care units, that kind of stuff till I came here.
What do you think it is about Mars Hill that is so special, that people talk about it being such a special play?
Well, I just think it's like a big family. And to me, I don't know how it is right now. I've been away from it a while, but when I was here, I felt like it was
a family.
There was a real sense of community here.
If you wanted somebody to write something on your tombstone, what do you think you'd like them to say about you?
Oh my. I don't know. You should have warned me.
I didn't think about it myself.
I don't know. That I was a good, I always wanted to, my first and foremost thing in life was to be a good mother. And good person, just a good person.
That's a great statement, right? A good mother, good person.
Yeah.
Ellen, it's been wonderful to talk to you. Thank you.